Great light. Hi, everyone. Welcome to our Zell Visiting Writer Series reading and Q&A with Karen Solie. My name is Shawnee, and I'm your host for this season. In case you don't yet know about our programming and what we do, the Helen Zell Writers Program brings 12 acclaimed authors to the University of Michigan each year to meet with our students and give public readings, craft talks, and Q&As, and the series is generously funded by Helen Zell and Janie Lack. I have just a few administrative announcements before we move towards the reading. Please note that this event is recorded and will be posted on the Zell Visiting Writers Series YouTube channel, where anyone can watch later on. If you are joining us on Zoom, closed captioning is enabled, which you can turn on or off by pressing the CC icon on the bottom of your Zoom screen. We'll also post a copy of Karen's reading in the Zoom chat shortly. And for the order of tonight's event, in just a minute, MFA student James Barden will introduce Karen. After that, Karen will give a reading for about 25 minutes. Around 6 p.m., another MFA student, Courtney Duchesne, will have a 20-minute conversation with Karen. And for the last 10 minutes, we'll open it up to audience questions, so you can line up at the mics in the aisles to ask questions, or if you need a mic walked to you, just raise a hand and we'll get you one. Zoom participants can submit their questions through the Q&A function, and we will read them aloud on your behalf. And now I'll hand it over to James for an introduction.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for being here. When reading any piece of art, we encounter things and wonder, what are they really? And what are they doing here? In Karen Solie's work, each of these things, images, backgrounds, interact with each other seamlessly. And the questions that follow feel inevitable and allow us to interrogate what poems themselves are doing here. How do they come to be? Her poems guide us uncomfortably through the things we have seen with absolute respect. Reading Caiplie Caves, one can't help but wonder whether it is permissible to retreat into solitude or to actively work for others. The word complicated comes to mind, but if everything is complicated, the word starts to empty itself. But isn't this precisely what we want from poems, unending complications that remind us what life is really like? Inhabiting a myriad of voices, never moralizing, Karen generously gives us the tools of her own reflections. Her work has received high praise for its philosophical contemplation and for retracing the steps we think language takes us. My experience with her work feels like something that comes to you out of nowhere, maybe on a walk. Brisk and contained, she conjures lines like, does it matter to us if we're outlived by a minute or 1,000 years? I'm not saying it should. Many of Karen's poems recolor the noise of the background in our waking life, which is to say, the motels, ugly theaters, superstores, the tractors are not merely part of the background. They too exert something. They are always exerting something, even when we're not looking. But one can easily notice this if one pays attention. She does this by pointing to relationships that mundane things have simply by being placed in proximity to each other. After reading her work, I must re-examine the nature of such things, like what is fog the harbinger of? What does a colossal tractor really cultivate? And as Karen beautifully puts it, ideas gather around phenomena as though for warmth. These are the things that poems cling to. Her work constantly reminds me of the inevitable balance between accident and intention, and how language always flourishes in both. She has received numerous prizes. The Griffin Poetry Prize, specifically Caiplie Caves in 2020, was a finalist for the T.S. Eliot Prize and the Derek Walcott Prize. Author of numerous books, The Road In is Not the Same Road Out, 2015, The Living Option Selected Poems, 2013, Pigeon, 2009, to name a few. Please join me in warmly welcoming Karen Solie. Thank you.
Thank you so much, James, for that kind introduction. And thanks to all of you for coming, and to Linda and Julie and Shawnee and Amanda and everyone who did so much work to organize this. I'm very grateful to be here. And I'm gonna read some poems from my manuscript in progress, which is a little bit unnerving sometimes. But I don't know, everything's unnerving, really, isn't it? So So I'm just going to do it. And the poems, a lot of them go back to where I grew up in Southwest Saskatchewan, in quite a isolated rural place. And it's something that I have come to terms with. When I first started writing, you know, I thought that, you know, I wrote poems about growing up on the farm. And then I thought, you know, I'll get beyond the farm. You know, I'm going to write sophisticated poems like my heroes do. And, you know, I'm going to start talking about the big things, the big ideas, and leave the farm behind. And at some point I realized that was just never going to happen. And that's where the big ideas are. So I'm going back there. So this is, I'm going to read start with a poem that is set out there, and it's called Well Water. I didn't know what I had. Drove the water truck underage to the well in a swimsuit, anointed with baby oil, to attempt a uniform exposure, a mild burn atop the tank as it filled in that burgeoning era of means to an end. It was a chore to attend this place of worship, from which song was drawn to feed the souls of planted trees unnatural to that place, as we were unnatural to that place. Our glyphosate on the wind, our malathion, dust of the gravel roads that bore vehicles of gas well company agents, fracking derricks across the county appearing before, as we said, we knew it. Blondie tore a strip off the wheat field. The tank cooled as the level rose, and I descended to start the engine so the radio wouldn't drain the battery. A mistake I'd made and lived to regret, which is the only way I ever learn anything. It took 75 minutes. The things you remember. My last act before closing the tap, to take the hose by the neck and drink, taste the cathedral's rock and temperature, the water hard and the table high. The water then, you could still drink it. I have lived in a lot of basement suites in my life. And most recently, because I go around for work and don't have a place of my own, I have had to make use of Airbnb, which often lands me in more basement suites. So this is called Basement Suite. Left to our use are the fixtures and appliances repented of by the homeowners who don't realize this is a way to know them. In the basement, one is closer to God, because closer to consequence, to the creatures no one loves but the specialists. Rice weevil, bean weevil, rose weevil, pea weevil, flower, black vine, and strawberry weevils. A weevil to every purpose under heaven. The basement is a treehouse in the roots. Think of it that way. And cold on five sides, like childhood. When water in the pipes was a talking animal, and it was advertised that soil neutralized the toxins applied to it, that our bodies did, and that the sea carried poison on its back into the hills. Our faces to the wall, to domestic passages beyond it, heartbeats and adjustments attenuated through the half space, lo-fi, the light is radio light. The house tries to forget we are here. Yet there are bars on the windows in some places, like childhood. A slight clinging smell is associated. Every living situation has one. It's not the underworld, for Christ's sake, which is everywhere, without depth. But the gaze does learn to creep along the baseboards and sharpen its knives on them. Walking on the surface again, if we can bear it, after so long sheltering in place, we may appreciate, more than anyone, a bit of natural warmth. Though money flows no more freely up here, look around you. I spend a lot of time in Toronto. It's really my home base. I was thinking one winter, looking out onto Riverdale Park in Toronto, of winters back home in Saskatchewan, and realizing that, you know, as a Gen X person, you look back on things that you remember fondly and also think, was that okay? But so this is called The Trees in Riverdale Park. Diagonal paths quadrisect a square acre, white as the page in February. From the soil of this basic geometry, ash, elm, and maple flourish like understandings whose bare logics are visible, understandings the theorem has allowed. Between roam bodies of the sensible world, people, dogs, all those lovers of the material and immaterial illumined as under working hypotheses by sodium bulbs whose costly inefficiencies Los Angeles and Philadelphia have apparently moved on from. The trees are grand hotels closed for the season. But below ground, social life is taking place. As when snow lay on the fields and people descended to rec rooms, secret bars, like the snake pit in the basement of the curling rink in Golden Prairie. Our big Ford nosing the siding, we waited for our parents with the engine running, under grave instruction, as radio sent our autonomy bounding toward us. Chilling scenarios inspired by the trucking forecast and news items from Great Falls or Bismarck freely imagined. Songs that gave us bad ideas and the seeds of a mythology. 10 minutes, then 1 hour, two. Pop and chips and the gift of the periphery. I've never understood what starlit means. Even on a clear night, in their millions, they cast no discernible light into the dark expanse where a farmhouse gestured weakly and grid roads and bullshit caragana disappeared, where the animals' lives played out, smells traveling slowly, low to the ground. In Riverdale Park, the diagonal walks, like diagrams, may be said to describe themselves, which is a relief. Now snow is blowing through the theorem that the understandings broadly accommodate and sensible bodies adjust their collars to, and even bare spots left by departed cars evidence how the outlines of loss might gradually alter. As experience is filled in by its representation, even if not made peace with. Speaking of the animals, I'm going to read a poem about that's called Antelope. Antelope pronghorns are one of the more ubiquitous animals where I grew up. And because they are so common, their weirdness is somehow sometimes goes out noticed or unnoticed. They are very weird animals, like a holdover from another time, intensely curious and intensely irritable. So this is called Antelope. They appear out of nowhere, as if they know where all the doors are, between our dimension and where they are called by their true name, are not the last survivors of their evolutionary niche. Understanding does not diminish their curiosity, and even the great plane aligned to the grid of monoculture is not monotony, which is painful to them, but a regularity that gives value to change. And what the fuck is that walking on the road? How annoying to be drawn into another pointless encounter with me. They huff, brandish their hardware and run, entering a sublimity of motion that is like the sublimity of night. A gothic spirit loves accumulation, magic, a big block V8 in a Dodge Polara. They feel inside themselves the soul of an extra gear that will lift them from the earth, from the prairie's hall of mirrors, the fence's whitetail leap that they must scrabble under, tearing their cloaks on the barbs. Only their old-timey machinery can digest the rough forbs. The jackrabbit finds peace in his evening hollow. Deer fold themselves in elegant anxiety upon their grass couches. But the pronghorn's eye has been widened in some backroom occult transaction, and he haunts the open country, a candle in the 5-mile corridor of his tenfold vision, sleeping minutes at a time under the shaking rings of Saturn. I'm going to read 4 poems now that resulted from a strange ongoing experience. I was trying, you know, I was in Berkeley, actually, in a rented place, Josephine Miles' house, actually. So it was filled with spirits of poems. And as poets do, I was blankly staring out the window, hoping for something to happen. And I began to think of a relative that I hadn't thought of in many years, and she stuck with me. And so the next 4 poems I'm going to read are based in that experience of being accompanied for a time by her. So this is called Next Life. Someone going for the blue of the sky was sold this earthly mist tint, a wall color that even in daylight feels threadbare, solitary, a little irritable, and probably lead-based, a blue that suits a crucifix in pride of place above the TV on its rolling collapsible metal stand. It's getting to be about that time to switch the lamps on. When she died, not much could be passed down. What she owned, worn through the core of its function, in rags, or with the true nature of its construction exposed. Beloved objects were of no worth, absent of her regard. And it was more than that, as though the spirit of her belongings, the remnants of utility and charm, had chosen to accompany her into the next life. The world used her right up, along with the little she'd been given. But everything she'd been given, she found a use for. Caribou. Why, after so many years, is she with me now? We who were not close in life walk among the caribou lichen, whose coral-like low forms, white against the mosses and wild blueberry in its red phase, seem to give off light. She has escaped through the window of the body's house of harm into the freedom of a truth that will never be recognized. And indeed, they do give off light, fungi, and algae in a collaboration that obscures the individual collaborators who've taken it entirely off spectrum, reflecting every wavelength and phosphorescing under the UV intensely, where appearing most delicate, as though, as has been written, the best metaphor for stillness is constant motion. Out of weakness are made strong, I guess. A cold, hardy, slow-growing, clean air species. The fog makes surprising what it does not conceal, and what is concealed reminds us that an excess of surprise should be avoided if one can help it. Listen to the sea, she says, surprising again and again the rock of the shore. The next poem is called Horseshoe, and it borrows, or it is derived from, some of the stories that you hear your relatives tell you over and over as a kid, and you wonder, what is the meaning of this? So this is one of those. Horseshoe. Seriously, in all that time, I asked, did your faith never waver? How unprepared you are for these moments, she said. Even as it might seem, your whole life has been preparing you. And though disinclined to such practices while alive, preferring that events speak for themselves, she told me a story. We were gathered, she said, at a long table beside the lilac trees, the family, and my brother out of hospital. After supper had finished, he recalled how his former music teacher, a brilliant pianist, but a cruel man, had died, if you can believe it, when a horseshoe nailed above his door fell on his head as he crossed the threshold. Despite my brother's talent, she said, his teacher told him repeatedly that a person of his emotional delicacy would never go anywhere. And, in fact, he didn't. The horseshoe had once belonged to what many local people considered the municipality's luckiest horse, who had been rescued after falling through river ice and had escaped miraculously unharmed when lightning struck a tree it was tied to. When later its cries warned the farmer the barn it was stabled in had caught fire, he swore the horse need never work again. I myself recall this horse, she said, a sturdy little strawberry roan renowned also for its gentleness. It lived to a very old age and died in the meadow it was born in. My brother's teacher was given its shoe before traveling to the city for a piano competition, which he won, and afterward gave as the reason he never again competed. But I know all this, I said. I heard it. I was there. A red and white checked oilcloth was attached with clothespins to the table. I wore a new sundress I hated and complained of. Afterward, Uncle laughed and said that none of it was true. But you weren't there, she said to me in my dream. Not if I don't remember you. And the last of these poems is called Mirrors. She once told me that as a child, she fantasized about going into hospital. It was long ago. Hospitals were different. Still, they are places where people are cared for. She might have had the wrong idea about hospitals, I don't know, and maybe about care. As to care for and to care, in practice, can diverge. The old English carrion, to grieve, to be anxious, to feel concern, originates in the Proto-Germanic caro, or lament, further rooted in the syllable for to call out or scream. Should those paid to care for us be expected to inhabit the excess of this progression from grief to lamentation? They truly are like family, in that duty of care is a job one can walk away from, even if only in the mind. In late Latin, hospitale is a guest house or inn. An alternate evolution of care is represented in the German karg, Dutch karig, frugal, stingy, scanty, mean. Positive applications, inclination, or fondness seem to have arisen later as mirrors to earlier meanings. And it can take some time to understand what side of the mirror you're on. Etymology is itself hospitable, like a brief stay in hospital, a place to recover. Perhaps basic hospitality was enough for her. Because if you decide something is enough, it's enough. All right, I have two more poems to read for you. The first is a road poem, a being on the road poem. It's called The Bluebird. Each old thing in its new place must prove its worth yet again. Dust is disturbed, having made itself at home among what former tenants have found wanting. A friend brings a gift to brighten my room, then leaves a cruel word to move in with me. Good and bad don't always line up opposite. Nearing the end of an earlier journey, I'd stopped at a roadside motel whose name ameliorated the experience of staying there not at all. Around it rose the dark forest of the Shield Country, endless differentiation appearing undifferentiated, though one had the sense of something slowly, unrelentingly being taken apart within. Ahead lay great happiness, great sorrow, and it seems to me now a decision was to be made between them, though the conditions for such a choice did not exist. The past is so poorly constructed, so unsuited to the living that must be done, we might wish for the forest to grow up around it. But knowledge can't replace the facts of its acquisition. They continue to perform in the events they set in motion, whether we remember them or not. I was hungry. It was very late. Across the four lanes, northbound, southbound, divided in my memory by a waist-high steel girder, a gas station convenience store's neon still awake. Seldom a break in the traffic. Footbridge miles away. To get to the other side quickly meant taking your life in your hands. This is a poem that rose from a memory of several memories, I suppose, of growing up on the prairies. I imagine everyone is familiar with the West Edmonton Mall or its existence. I started to think about, you know, you go through stages where, you know, when you're a kid, West Edmonton Mall, it's amazing. There's a wave pool and the skating rink and all this, all the things, and it's like this magical place. And then another stage of your life, you're like, malls are stupid. And then you sort of look back on the things that you've previously considered mediocre just like emblems of mediocrity, and you see some value in them. So this is called Holiday at the Wave Pool. Warmish, oft bathed in. Pride of the second most visited and largest mall by gross leasable area on the northern subcontinent. Was it not in a childhood when travel meant Edmonton, astonishing, a wonder of the world? And on the other side of the intervening years, during which acknowledgement was sought, sometimes deserved, and occasionally won, when individuality hardened the heart and mysteries into problems, is it not a respite from the buses in March, from all the falling, and soothing to the shoulders and the knees? Stroll without your heavy coat along the ice-free corporate boulevards, out of the wind, road salt, the violently arbitrary real, and get your steps in. You in the light of your living, you one-off among the wings repeating franchises, we of the just looking thanks, can we dance inside a little to the serviceable pop, cry when it's sad in front of everybody? This humor called sorrow is inevitable as the food courts devoted to each stage of life and corresponding institution. A water feature beneath potted trees who've unfocused their eyes forever is a place to enjoy without buying, like nature. Pretty decent. It could be worse. With mom and newborn brother in hospital, we left our square of lawn tied to the clothes horse shivering in back of the duplex and went every night to McDonald's. My dad, little sister, and me, him not knowing what else to do with us. And my God, it was glorious. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much for being here tonight, Karen.
Oh, my pleasure.
Lovely poems. You mentioned at the beginning of the reading, when you were a younger poet trying to avoid writing about the rural landscape where you grew up, and as someone who also grew up in a rural landscape and tried to avoid writing about that for a time, I'm curious, what brought you back to that subject despite maybe some initial insecurity as a young poet?
You know, it's interesting. I suppose I realized on one hand that it's my pool of metaphors. Mm-hmm. It's how I gauge distance and the time it takes to travel through, to travel distances. It's my sense of scale, mm-hmm. You know, the way if you're from the flatland, mm-hmm. And you're in the mountains, and then you come out of the mountains again, it's just like, everything's back to scale again, you know? And so that was part of it. It became, the further away I was from it and saw it in relief, mm-hmm. the more interesting it became, and the more idiosyncratic and odd and interesting it became, as things do, I suppose, when you see them in relief. But I suppose at a certain period, I had equated the farm and the work on the farm and just the culture as being not as intellectual as I wanted to be, mm-hmm. which is wrong, you know, that idea that that the intellectual resides in the urban and in places like this and not like in places where mm-hmm. we're from, I realized is wrong. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of continuing that feeling of of revisiting a place, seeing it in relief against other places, and recognizing its the things that are interesting about it, for better and for worse.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. When you talk about it, you know, being the sense of scale or the places where your metaphors reside, a worship leader once told me it's the psychic landscape of my life, and that's really how it feels sometimes.
Yeah, definitely.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. The subjects of these poems are so different than your most recent book, The Caiplie Caves. And I'm curious how you approach tackling these different subjects. You do both forms like very well, you know, when you talk about the wanting to write these more intellectual poems, those are amazing too. And then this is amazing. But I'm curious how you decide what to put in a book.
Oh, I wish I knew. It's just, you know, it's kind of about just whatever's going on at the time, really. You know, it would be nice to be able to plan ahead somewhat, but that hasn't really worked mm-hmm. out so well for me in pretty much any respect. Mm-hmm. So, and the thing about poems too, I mean, the stakes, you know, outside of the poem itself and one's investment in the poems as a reader and as a writer, all other investments in poems are pretty low. So you should do what you want. Uh-huh. There's no reason not to pursue what you want to do. You know, it's not like, oh, I'm going a more commercial route with my poems this time. No, it's not really a thing. So you might as well do what you want. And it just happened with the Caiplie Caves. I'd spent a lot of time in Scotland. I came across the caves. I was interested in finding out more, and that led me on this whole route. It was also a very strange time in my life, and I needed something I could really immerse myself in and do the research that I needed to do, which I love. Mm-hmm. I love research very much, mm-hmm. to a fault, I think, almost. I will do it. If I could just do that, I would just do that. Yeah, so it just kind of is what happened. And now with these new poems, it was not a plan. At some point you start writing poems and the stack gets a little bigger mm-hmm. over the years. And it's like, okay, well, I guess that's what it is.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And that's two very different approaches between the projects. You know, there's this research intensive process and then this like starts coming to you. Yeah. Pieces with the poems. Did it ever feel like, oh no, this is different? I'm not sure if I'm writing a book correctly. I feel like every time I sit down to write a poem, it feels like a new experience somehow and a little bit scary and intimidating.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, every poem feels that way. Mm-hmm. And the book, you know, with the Caiplie Caves, I was writing these things and it's like a 7th century Scottish monk living in a cave. You know, mm-hmm. who possibly, what possible relevance will this have? But, and the way I was, you know, thinking about, I had never considered a book length project before, and it just started to happen. And I was talking to poet friends of approximately my own age, and they were like, oh yeah, it's the midlife project book. Here goes. I'm like, great. But you know, yeah, but it felt like a huge disaster, like all the way through. It was like, this is a terrible idea. But it was the idea that I had and that I wanted. I was deeply interested in it. And there's however ridiculous the idea might seem, there's a great solace, a great comfort, and a great value in being truly interested in something. Mm-hmm. Just really interested in it. I mean, that, and I was. And so... in some ways, I miss that mm-hmm. that monk now.
The best place for poems sometimes can be these obsessions.
Yeah.
I'm curious what resonated with you about the figure of Ethernon. What felt important about the story of this 7th century monk who was living in these caves as a hermit?
Well, it was just an impossible position. And I think that the notion of retreat had interested me you know, that position really at the crux of a decision and what it might mean to stall making that decision,
mm-hmm.
you know, to remain in that moment out of fear, mm-hmm. Of doing the wrong thing, fear of error. The geography of the caves was also compelling because when you go in there and look out through the opening of the caves, the remnants of which, just the back part of them, still exists. But when you look out through the opening of the cave, May Island, where he was trying to decide whether or not to go out there to establish a priory, and that decision would have meant that he would die out there. So he was, you know, staring at that. It's like the pupil of an eye. It's like right when you look out the caves, it's right there. So he would have been staring at that thing,
mm-hmm.
all day, every day, feeling it at nighttime when he couldn't see it, you know. So I got a little obsessed with May Island myself while I was living in Crail. But just that, I guess the intensity of that position of having to make a life-changing decision was compelling to me.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. The Ethernon poems are not the only poems in that book. I'm curious how you see the other poems resonating thematically, or why it felt important to include these poems, many of which have a more contemporary view in this project.
Yeah, well, that was a thing to think about, you know, in terms of what the book was going to be. But then again, like, I was out there, I spent a lot of time in Crail, and I just kind of wrote the poems that were coming.
Mm-hmm.
In some way or another, all of the poems are kind of orbiting that location, and have to do with money and faith and war and violence and power and all the sorts of things that still bear on our decisions now.
Mm-hmm.
Came to bear on his. So that was kind of the what the poems were all revolving around, aspects of that. And, you know, I would just, you know, I went to strange little local museums. I walked endlessly up and down the coastal path, and stupid things happened. And, you know, as they do. And just, you know, tried to sort of write the poems as they were coming. And when I was at the point where I thought, oh, I haven't written a poem about such and such, I should write a poem about such and such, then I was like, you have to quit now. Because that was like, it was becoming like the idea of the project was taking over the actual interest that I had.
You mentioned going to these strange little museums. I'm curious, what was the strangest thing you saw in one of the museums?
Oh, well, these aren't necessarily strange per se, but the Scottish Fisheries Museum in Anstruther has transcriptions of diaries from fishermen in the Firth of Forth throughout different eras. And they're really fascinating. I found out that a local landmark used to be a target for bombers during the war. They would drop bags of flour on it,
mm-hmm.
to practice bombing runs. So yeah, all these little details about the place, and all of the stories too. And a lot of local history is actually wrapped up, place names and all of that is wrapped up on these stories of hermits and saints and holy people and who were everywhere in that area, according to the stories. And so I learned a lot of those stories, some of which are fascinating, and it creates this sense of, you know, you find out some strange events that happened on May Island or on the Bass Rock. And when you're there, it's like all the eras are happening at once. Like all of the time, it becomes this weird palimpsestic experience. So
mm-hmm.
Yeah, that fed into a lot of it.
And makes sense in the way the book is layered with, you know, these more contemporary poems speaking to the poems of the past, creating that kind of palimpsest.
Yeah, I kind of hope that would be part of the effect. Yeah.
Absolutely. You mentioned loving research, and I'm curious, as you're writing more of these personal poems, have they taken you down any research rabbit holes?
Some of them have, yeah. Even if it's just, well, I guess thinking about one's own past isn't really research, but there are a few poems, you know, thinking about the antelope, for example. Mm-hmm. And I was idly avoiding work at some point and ran across information that the antelope, its nearest living relative now is the giraffe.
Oh, that's fascinating.
I know, right? It's like, okay, excellent. And then, so it's like reading up a little about the antelope, because when they're everywhere, you just sort of think they're there, and you walk down the road and they're really curious. And so they come up, they've seen you like a million times, and they're like, what is that? And they come up, and then they get mad at you for making them curious to come and see. And then they stomp and shake their heads at you and stuff. But I was happy because it was like, now I have to find out more about antelope and their eyesight is approximately 10 times the magnification of ours. They can see things 5 miles away, and supposedly their eyesight is clear enough that they can see the rings of Saturn.
That's incredible.
I don't know. I'm not an antelope expert, but you know, coupled with the strangeness that invests ubiquitous things that are ubiquitous, mm-hmm. It's strange. Like when you start to notice things that are everywhere, they start to become very weird. So it turns out they are weird.
Like you said at the beginning, that's what leaving home does. It throws everything in refresh. You can see these idiosyncrasies.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much. I'm going to turn it over to the audience for the Q&A now. And if there are questions on Zoom, you can put them in the chat and we will read them out for you. Yeah. And there are microphones on either side for people in the audience.
Whoa.
I was going to say they usually throw up the lights so we can see.
I don't know either. I think that a lot of it is just, I don't know. This is just sort of a practical thing, I guess, but I really feel like I do my best writing in revision, and I do a lot of revision. Mm-hmm. And my first efforts are mostly awful. But I guess it's kind of a gradual process of revisiting things. I feel like one of the comforts I take in writing poems is what a puzzle they are. I feel like if everything else is terrible, I can go there and have this puzzle to work with, you know? And a lot of it for me is syntactical. I like, you know, we all have our ways of thinking about writing, and there's no one way that's better than another. And then maybe it's because I grew up around machines, but I think of it almost like a machine. And it's that strange combination of, or it's the simultaneity of the really nuts and bolts technical aspects of writing and intuition. Like, I can't separate those two things. And it feels to me like, you know, you're tinkering with a machine and you're listening for how it sounds. And then all of a sudden it's like, okay, there it is. And it's because of some little thing, like some adjustment to the syntax, some adjustment to tense, some recognition that, okay, I've used two verbs there, but that's the real one. And that other one is just sort of diluting, like it's water in the wine, so to speak. So I guess that's how I kind of approach it. I really am a strong believer in that the magic and the feeling and the intuitive part of it is in the mechanics of the language. I don't know if that's...
Hello. So I was really interested in what you were talking about with kind of research and kind of approaching that project of the Caiplie Caves. And as someone who's working through my own midlife crisis project collection about a decade early, I'm curious if you have thoughts about kind of ways to manage like information for the reader, or sort of how you manage those like moments of reader buy-in, or what you sort of ask them to do as they follow you down your own kind of research rabbit hole.
Yeah, that's actually a good question. And there are pitfalls to research, of course. And one of them is just too much information and going down into the rabbit hole and thinking, I have all these great facts, like I have to use all of them, right? And sometimes it can be too much. And it's like, just speaking for myself, many edits, I go back many times and see in poems where I have too much stuff. And it's like, this is interesting to me, but it's not the poem. Like it's not really what the poem needs. And that always takes the time of going back to it as a reader and looking at all of these. I also like, research can give me a vocabulary that satisfies my love of syllables and odd words and words that feel to me have metaphorical resonance. And so all of the facts and the information sometimes feed my tendency to write syntax that is too, it's too much, it's too gnarled, it's too syllable-y. And it's like, it pleases me, I think it's fun, but it can be airless sometimes. And so I have to be aware of that tendency in my own writing, and it's fed by learning the names of chemicals and the names of like obscure foliage and, you know, things like that. So there is a danger there. And I think it's also true that I've spent hours of research into something in the library on site, writing notes, and I've used one word that I found in all of it, and am happy for that. But sometimes research is about mood, and you know, getting the mood, getting the atmosphere of something. But yeah, the too much information thing, it is a danger. And so I think it's always worth going back and just seeing when things have, like, you have too many logs in the river, and at one point in the poem they're just like sitting there. So yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
I'm in a undergraduate creative writing course, mostly focusing on poetry. and I'm kind of freaking out about my portfolio that I have to do that I have to do at the end of the course. How do you like, what's your process with just getting something into a book or publishing? Like, how do you like say no to like revising more?
I usually, my revision process stops when they drag it out of my hands. In terms of, you know, it's also true, if you're thinking about I just want to make sure that I understand what you mean. There are so many, like, there are so many opportunities in putting together a group of poems, and there are also so many things to worry about that are like hard to negotiate. Do you mean stopping revising poems so that you can write new poems for the portfolio?
I meant more like stopping revising each poem that you're looking to put into the portfolio and just like finishing it, making it like a cohesive product.
Right. Okay. Yeah. The cohesion aspect is always interesting because sometimes as writers, I don't think we necessarily realize what's holding the thing together as readers can see it. Because the poems are coming out of our head in a certain period of time, there's going to be something there that connects them. Like there's going to be something, oftentimes things that we don't see ourselves as writers. So my inclination is to say to trust that in some way they will cohere. And when a person doesn't want to get into the position, in my opinion anyway, of like, oh, I have to fill in this space that I feel is left, so I have to write this poem that fills in this space. I don't know that that's where it comes from. I think if you write the poems that you want to write in a certain period of time, there's something that's going to allow them to hang together. Because what's going to allow them to hang together is you, your brain, having produced them. So, but in terms of revision, of just letting things go, it's really hard to let things go because they change, right? One week after the next, they change because we change, and you read something more and you think of something else, and it could be a person could write just work on one poem like for their whole life. Either if it's a portfolio or a manuscript that you're submitting to a publisher, at some point that's the best you can do on that work at this time, and then you send it in because it's not going to be the last thing that you do. It's just the start of all the other work you're going to be doing. So it's just part of a much longer process. It feels like the be-all and end-all at the time, like I have to get this perfect, but it's never going to be that. Perfect doesn't exist. It's not a thing. So just, I know it is hard, but it's the best work. It represents your interests. It represents your enthusiasm. It represents the best work that you could do at the time. So give it to the world and then on to the next, right?
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much, Karen, for your wonderful reading and those amazing words of wisdom. Thank you, Courtney, for facilitating the Q&A, James, for your introduction, and Amanda for co-hosting on Zoom. As a reminder, Karen will give a craft talk tomorrow from 10 to 11 a.m. titled The Path of the Hare. All are welcome to join in person in Angel Hall 3222, or you can join us via Zoom at the same link as tonight's event. If you'd like to receive notifications about our events in the future, you can sign up for our email list on the sign-up sheet in the table right by the auditorium door, or if you're on Zoom, by following the link dropped in the chat. We also have a table outside the auditorium where you can buy Karen's books from Literati and have her sign your copy before you go. Many thanks again for coming out, and enjoy the rest of your evening.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you.